This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book. Handbook 2, The Mennonite Hymnary by Lester Hostetler, B.D. 1. Definition of a hymn. St. Augustine, 354-430, gave a definition of a hymn, which has been widely accepted. A hymn is the praise of God by singing. A hymn is a song embodying the praise of God. If there is merely praise, but not praise of God, it is not a hymn. If there be praise and praise of God but not sung, it is not a hymn. For it to be a hymn, it is needful, therefore, for it to have three things: praise, praise of God, and these sung. A recent definition, accepted by the Hymn Society of America, is that of the late Carl F. Price. A Christian hymn is a lyric poem, reverently and devotionally conceived, which is designed to be sung and which expresses the worshiper's attitude toward God or God's purposes in human life. L.F. Benson, America's foremost hymnologist, defines a hymn in these simple words. The Christian hymn is a form of words appropriate to be sung or chanted in public devotions. A hymn is to be sung by a congregation. Its message must be simple, not subtle. It must read well and sing well. In modern usage, the hymn is not limited to the praise of God, but includes other moods of worship such as resignation and consecration. 2. The beginnings of Christian song. Hymn singing has always been associated with Christian worship. Jesus and the 12 sang a hymn, presumably a portion of the Hallel, after the supper was ended. Paul and Silas sang hymns, songs of the night, during the midnight hours of their imprisonment in Philippi. The great apostle recognized the value of song when he exhorted the churches thus: "Be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord." Eph. 5:18-19. "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord." Col 3:16. "I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also." Icor 14:15. The Jewish converts who at first composed the church had a rich heritage of song in the Book of Psalms. This was their hymn book, used in the temple worship and in the home, and probably also in the synagogue services. The use of the Psalms, carried over from the Jewish service, forms to this day an important element in Christian worship. Besides the Psalms, the early church sang the Nativity lyrics that adorn the first two chapters of the Gospel of Luke. It also made extensive use of Hallelujah as a part of the people's praise, adding in the course of time the Gloria Patri, the Sanctus, the Te Deum, and other canticles. The Nativity hymns in Luke, 5 in all, are extensively used in Roman Catholic and Anglican services. Ave Maria, Hail Mary. 1:28-29, 42-45. The Salutation of Gabriel and of Elizabeth. Magnificat. My soul doth magnify the Lord. 1:46-55. Hymn of the Virgin Mary. Benedictus. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel. 1:68-79. Song of Zacharias. Nunc Dimittis. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace. 2:29-32. Song of Simeon. Gloria in excelsis. Glory to God in the highest. 2:14. Song of the Angels. Used as a part of the Roman Mass and often found in Protestant hymns, e.g., Angels We Have Heard on High. Beginnings of Christian Song in the Hymnary. Psalms. Book 5. Gloria Patri. Ter Sanctus Trisagion, Holy, Holy, Holy. Te Deum. Holy God, we praise thy name. A metrical translation of an ancient version. 3. Hymns of the Eastern Church, Greek and Syriac. The ancient Eastern Church developed a rich hymnody, rising steadily in the 4th century until it reached its culmination in the 8th and 9th centuries. Since it employed the Greek and Syriac languages, its hymnic treasures remained almost completely hidden and unknown to the English-speaking churches for many centuries. It is only in recent years, through the efforts of scholars like John Mason Neal and Edward Caswall, that some of the Eastern hymns have been translated and made available for modern use. Eastern hymns are characterized by an objective, dignified contemplation of God. Except when confessing sin and unworthiness, they contain nothing of the subjective feelings of the worshiper, such as is found in many modern hymns. Though there is very little in the hymnary from the Eastern Church, our collection is enriched by the inclusion of a small number of hymns from this source. Greek hymns in the hymnary. Clement of Alexandria, 170-220, Shepherd of Tender Youth. Candle Lighting Hymn, O Gladsome Light. Synesius, circa 375-430, Lord Jesus, Think on Me. Saint Germanus, 634-734, A Great and Mighty Wonder. Saint John of Damascus, 8th century, The Day of Resurrection. Come Ye Faithful, Raise the Strain. Saint Stephen the Sabbite, 725-94, Art Thou Weary, Heavy Laden. Candle Lighting Hymn, Darkening Night, The Land Doth. 4. Hymns of the Western Church, Latin. Two great names are associated with the music of the Western Church: Ambrose, circa 340-97, known as the father of hymnody in the Western Church, and Gregory the Great, 540-604, the missionary-minded pope and reformer of church music. Ambrose, Bishop of Milan, not only composed hymns and music, but stimulated others to do the same. Under his leadership, there developed a large body of church music based upon four scales, which came to be known as Ambrosian chant. Although widely known as a scholar, theologian, and preacher, Ambrose's most lasting influence was upon the music of the church. None of his hymns are found in our collection. Gregory the Great, two centuries later, carried forward the work of Ambrose. He added four more scales or modes to the Ambrosian system, thus giving to the repertory of church music more definiteness and variety. The music that developed during the papacy of Gregory came to be known as Gregorian chant, or plain song or plain chant. It is plain because unadorned, unharmonized, and unmeasured. Its rhythm is the free rhythm of speech, the beats falling irregularly. The Gregorian chant remained the music of the church for 1,000 years, and forms the basis of all Roman Catholic music today. Some of these chants were adapted by Luther for congregational singing and set to words in the vernacular of the people. A few of the tunes, usually in a form scarcely recognizable from the original, are used today in Protestant hymnals, as for instance, the tune Hamburg. Some of the music in the Amish church services is traceable to the Gregorian chant. The singing in the medieval church was liturgical in character and confined to the clergy and trained choirs. This was its weakness. The laity was not expected to sing, neither were they able to do so. Congregational singing, so important in our worship today, had for centuries been unknown in the Roman Catholic Church. Reform was inevitable, and it came in due time. While only remnants of the music survive, many hymns from the Western Church have been translated from the Latin, and a few choice ones have found their way into the hymnary. Latin hymns in the hymnary. Prudentius, 348, circa 413, Bethlehem of noblest cities. Gregory the Great, 540-604, Father, we praise thee. Anonymous, 6th or 7th century, Christ is made the shore. Joy dawned again on Easter Day. Theodulf of Orleans, 9th century, All glory, laud, and honor. Bernard of Clairvaux, 1091-1153, Jesus the very thought. O sacred head now wounded. Bernard of Cluny, 12th century, Jerusalem the golden. Anonymous 12th century, O Come Emmanuel. Savonarola, 1452-98, Italian, Jesus, Refuge of the Weary. Anonymous, 17th-18th centuries, O Come All Ye Faithful. The Year Is Gone Beyond Recall. 5. Hymns of the Bohemian Brethren. The followers of John Huss, who came to be known as the Bohemian Brethren, and later as the Moravians, were the first Protestant group to introduce congregational singing into their worship. They also published the first Protestant hymn books, one in 1501 and another in 1505, containing 89 and 400 hymns respectively in their native Bohemian tongue. Their efforts to introduce congregational singing were sternly opposed by the Roman hierarchy. The Council of Constance condemned Huss to be burned at the stake and warned his successor, Jacob of Missy, to cease the singing of hymns in the churches. It decreed, "If laymen are forbidden to preach and interpret the scriptures, much more are they forbidden to sing publicly in the churches." As a result of their persecution, the brethren in 1508 sent out messengers to search for true Christian people into whose communion they might apply for admission, one to Russia, one to Greece, one to Bulgaria, and one to Palestine and Egypt. All returned unsuccessful. No such Christians had been found. They therefore remained in their own country, giving themselves assiduously to the translation and printing of the Bible. In 1522, the brethren sent two messengers to Luther to greet him and ask his advice. Luther became interested in them and welcomed their fellowship. He was impressed with the hymn book the brethren had published, and later used some of the hymns in his own work. Two centuries later, the brethren, known now as the Moravians, settled on Count Zinzendorf's estates in Saxony, spreading rapidly from thence into other countries in Europe and to the United States. One of England's foremost hymn writers and hymnologists, James Montgomery, was an adherent to their faith. Bohemian Brethren and Moravian Hymns in the Hymnary. Michael Weisse, 1480-1534, Christ the Lord is Risen Again. Tunes, MIT Freudenzart Ravenshaw. Von Zinzendorf, Nikolaus L., 1700-60, Jesus, Still Lead On. Von Zinzendorf, Christian R., 1724-62, Man of Sorrows. Henriette Louise von Hain, 1724-82, I Am Jesus' Little Lamb. James Montgomery, 1771-1854, Hail to the Lord's Anointed. Angels from the Realms of Glory. Go to Dark Gethsemane, and many others. 6. Hymns of the Reformation, the German Chorales. The movement toward congregational singing, inaugurated by the Bohemian Brethren, was soon to be merged into the greater Reformation movement. Luther's influence on the worship and music of the church was revolutionary. For 1,000 years, the layman had had no part in church song. Congregational singing was unknown. Ambrosian music had at first been introduced for congregational use, but it became more and more liturgical, thrusting the laity into the background. The Gregorian chant which followed was never intended for use, except by the priests and trained choirs. The followers of Huss pioneered in congregational singing, but it was Luther and his followers who brought it into full fruition. Luther was a born music lover and a musician of adequate training. Moreover, he possessed a remarkable gift for writing hymns in clear thought to bring the Word of God home to the hearts of the common people. He and his followers put songs on the lips of the German people, and they sang themselves into the Reformation. So effective were these songs that his enemies in the Roman Church declared that Luther's songs have damned more souls than all his books and speeches. Chorales. The word chorale, choral in German, refers to the hymn tunes of Lutheran Protestantism, though in common usage the term includes the words associated with the tunes. The melodies had much to do with the popularity of the songs. They came from various sources. Many of them were original compositions by Luther and others, Some were borrowed from the hymn books of the Bohemian Brethren. A considerable number were adaptations of plain songs used in the Catholic Church. Still others were adopted from beloved folk songs. Luther was an eclectic in his choice of music. He used any tune from any source that suited his purpose. Many thousands of chorales came into existence in Germany during his time and the two centuries that followed. The hundreds still in use represent the best in church music today. They are characterized by a plain melody, a strong harmony, and a stately rhythm, all of which adapts them well for effective congregational singing. The chorales at first did not have the regular rhythms that they later took on. The steady progression of even notes, invariable in Bach's day, had come only gradually into use. Some of the recent hymn books, in the interest of greater variety of rhythm, are returning to the original rhythmic chorales. Though unison singing has been widely practiced and is advocated today by some good authorities in church music, Luther encouraged part singing. In his first preface to the Geistliches Gesangbuchlein, 1525, he wrote, "These songs have been set in four parts for no other reason than because I wish to provide our young people, who both will and ought to be instructed in music and other sciences, with something whereby they might rid themselves of amorous and carnal songs, and in their stead learn something wholesome, and so apply themselves to what is good with pleasure, as becometh the young." The period of the German chorales may be said to have begun with Luther, 1483-1546, and ended two centuries later with J.S. Bach, 1685-1750. Bach brought the chorale tunes to their highest perfection, using many of them in his larger choral works. He composed about 30 original chorale melodies, wrote reharmonizations for approximately 400, and composed many chorale preludes for the organ which are in wide use today. The German hymns and chorale tunes, used constantly in the home and school as well as in the church, have been of great importance in our Mennonite worship in the past. They constitute the main body of material in all our German collections of hymns. In an effort to preserve and emphasize this rich heritage, there was incorporated into the hymnary a special section, Book 3, made up exclusively of chorales. German chorales in the hymnary. 16th century. Martin Luther, 1483-1546, "A mighty fortress is our God. From heaven above to earth I come. Out of the depths I cry to thee." Nikolaus Selnecker, 1532-92, "Now cheer our hearts." Philip Nicolai, 1556-1608, "Wake, awake, for night is flying. How brightly shines the morning star." 17th century. 1. Period of the Thirty Years' War, 1618-48. Johann Hermann, 1585-1647, "Ah, dearest Jesus." Josua Stegmann, 1588-1632, "Abide with us, our Savior." Matthias von Lohenstern, 1594-1648, "Lord of our life." Georg Weissel, 1590-1635, "Lift up your heads." Heinrich Albert, 1604-51, "God who maddest earth." Ernst Homburg, 1605-81, "Christ the life of all the living." Michael Schirmer, 1606-73, "O Holy Spirit, enter in." Paul Gerhardt, 1607-76, "O Sacred Head, now wounded," and others. Gerhard Terstegen, 1697-1769, "God reveals his presence. O power of love, all else transcending." 2. Later 17th century. Johann Franck, 1618-77, "Deck thyself, my soul." Tobias Klausnitzer, 1619-84, "Liebster Jesu, wer sinned higher." Georg Neumark, 1621-81, "He who would be in God." Johann Scheffler, 1624-77, "I am the Lord, O hear my voice." Joachim Neander, 1650-80, "Heaven and earth, the sea." 18th century. Johann Mentzer, 1658-1734, "O that I had a thousand voices." Erdmann Neumeister, 1671-1756, Sinners Jesus Will Receive. Benjamin Schmolke, 1672-1737, My Jesus As Thou Wilt. Philip F. Hiller, 1699-1769, O Son of God We Wait For. What Mercy and Divine Compassion. Christian F. Gellert, 1715-69, How Great Almighty Is Thy. Johann Sebastian Bach, 1685-1750. The life of the great musician marks the close of the German chorale period, and for that reason his name is placed here. None of Bach's original chorale melodies are found in the Hymnary, but use is made of a number of his harmonizations. 7. Hymns of the Reformation, the Metrical Psalms. While the German people, under the leadership of Luther, were singing chorales set to original religious poems, a large section of Protestantism, under the influence of John Calvin, confined itself to the singing of psalms. To the French reformer, now preaching at Geneva, hymns were man-made, whereas the psalms were the inspired word of God and the only proper vehicle for the praise of God. Calvin, unlike Luther, was not a musician, and at first permitted only unison singing, unaccompanied. Part singing and instrumental accompaniment seemed to savor of the frivolous and worldly, an opinion which Calvin, however, was soon to modify. For 200 years, the Calvinistic churches on the continent and in Britain were influenced in their worship song by the strict views of Calvin, limiting themselves to the metrical psalms and scriptural paraphrases. The German people, in the meantime, produced a rich treasury of original religious lyrics, contributed by some of their best poets. Psalter tunes and metrical psalms in the Hymnary. Genevan Psalter tunes, 1551. O Seigneur. Old 134th. Ronde Aigu. Old 124th. Old 100th. Scottish Psalter, 1650. Book 5, with a few exceptions. New Version, 1696, Tate and Brady. Through all the changing scenes of life, as pants the heart for cooling streams, O come, loud anthems let us sing, while shepherds watch their flocks by night. 8. Psalm Versions. The use of the psalms in singing, first on the continent, then in England and Scotland, and later in America, brought forth many metrical versions of the Psalter, the principal ones being the following. A. The Genevan Psalter, begun 1539, published complete in 1562. It was made at the request of John Calvin by Clement Merritt, court poet of France, and Theodore Beza, a French scholar. It became the psalm book for the Reformation churches on the continent, and is spoken of as the most famous book of praise the Christian Church ever produced. It was issued in at least 1,000 editions and translated into a number of tongues. Some of the original tunes are still in use, e.g., Old 100th. B. The Anglo-Genevan Psalter, Geneva, 1556. This was used by John Knox, the Scottish reformer, and his followers who fled the persecutions of Bloody Mary and formed a congregation at Geneva. The book incorporated some of the Sternhold and Hopkins versions which were in use in England, and added others. C. The Old Version, Sternhold and Hopkins, completed in 1562. Used in England for 134 years. It is entitled The Whole Book of Psalms, but came to be known as the Old Version. D. The Bay Psalm Book, Boston, 1640. This was the first book printed in English-speaking America. It was made to obtain greater literalness to the Hebrew original than was found in the versions then in use. The book reigned supreme among the English churches in New England for over a century. 70 editions of it were printed in America, the last in 1773. 18 editions appeared in England, and 22 in Scotland. There were no tunes given it until 1698, then only 13 with the air in the bass. E. the Scottish Psalter, completed 1650. Special mention is made of this version of the Psalms because it is the source of nearly all the selections of metrical psalms which constitute Book 5 of the Hymnary. The number of versions and editions of psalms which appeared on the continent and in England were numerous and confusing, each claiming its own special merits. Finally, in the interests of better literary diction and greater unity in singing, in the Scottish Presbyterian churches, the General Assembly authorized a new version. The result, after many years' work, was the famous Scottish Psalter of 1650, which remains the standard work in Scotland today. There is a certain dignified crudeness in some of the literary expressions, but the Psalms have long been learned in this version, and have become an important part of the religious training and experience of millions of English-speaking people, especially in Scotland. The Scottish Psalter first appeared with words only. There were no notes and no suggestions for melodies. The succeeding 100 years were a time of confusion. The tunes used were few in number, such as the leaders had learned from various sources and passed on to succeeding generations by rote. The time came when better singing and better tunes were demanded, and gradually the Psalter appeared with tunes. Early tune versions put the melody invariably in the tenor. The latest edition, printed in 1929 by the Oxford Press, contains the best psalm tunes which had gradually come into use, many of them arranged with faux bourdon, wherein the congregation sings one or more verses to the melody while the choir supplies the harmony, and descant, a second melody over that of the tune. F. The new version, Tate and Brady, London, 1696. This version gradually supplanted the old version of Sternhold and Hopkins, and held its place in the worship of the church for 150 years. It was adopted in 1789 by the Protestant Episcopal Church in the United States and bound with the prayer book of that communion. The above versions are only a few of the large number of psalters that were published by the Calvinistic churches on the continent, in Great Britain, and in America. The metrical psalms were designed for the singing church. They were intended to restore song to the people in their worship, serving in this respect a similar purpose to the chorales in Germany. Some of the psalm books were published without music, some with the melody only, and others in four-part harmony. The statement is frequently made that Calvinistic Protestantism approved only unison singing. The appearance of numerous books, complete with four voice parts, points to the contrary. It is true that Calvin at first encouraged unison singing only, regarding harmony more in the nature of amusement than the worship of God, but upon observing the effectiveness of singing in Germany, he soon changed his views and became more liberal in this respect. 9. English Hymnody. The youthful, courageous Isaac Watts, 1674-1748, an ardent dissenter, pioneered the movement which resulted in a flood of hymns and hymn books in the English churches. Watts was not satisfied with the psalm singing of his time, which by now had become formal and lifeless. Parts of the Psalter, he pointed out, were obviously not written in the spirit of the gospel. By keeping too close to David, he wrote in one of his prefaces, the veil of Moses is thrown over our hearts. Watts removed that veil, Christianizing the Psalms and composing during his lifetime more than 600 original hymns, expressing in the language of the time the thoughts of the worshipers. Through his influence, his age, the 18th century, became the first age of hymn singing in England. John and Charles Wesley, following Watts, made enormous use of hymn singing in their evangelistic work, giving the movement for congregational singing a powerful impetus. Charles is said to have composed over 6,000 hymns. From the Wesleys onward through the 19th century, the hymn writers in England became numerous. The restrictive shackles of psalm singing had been broken, and the creative urge to worship in new forms resulted in a vast number of original religious lyrics and the publication of hundreds of hymn books. The development can be summarized here only in outline form. English hymnody in the hymnary. Early 17th century. Henry Wotton, 1568-1639.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.